Hi, everybody. Me again, Jonathan, on another episode of Story Mode. And I am here with Jose Chavez to talk about one of his favorite games. Before we talk about your favorite game, tell us more about yourself.
Well, all right. Well, my name is Jose, like Johnny introduced. I'm 26. I usually play fighting games, but I try to be, I don't try to be one of those guys where they just stick to one genre. I try to be flexible as I can to play other types of games. Like, I grew up playing Mario, Mario Kart or Donkey Kong and stuff, but for me, like, fighting games have always been, like, the one type of game that I love with a passion. But I do have my moments where I play other genre type of games, because basically the game has to appeal to me to play outside of fighting games, so.
Well, that's cool. Do you have any other side projects that you've been doing, or are you part of any communities or anything?
Yeah, I'm actually part of the fighting game community. Like, I am, like, one of my friends in the community, he goes by Nick. He says I'm kind of like a chameleon because he regularly sees me in the BlazBlue community and Guilty Gear, because we go back and forth between those communities. And I, because I love fighting games, I try to be part of the community as a whole. So I'm basically a chameleon. I practically try to blend in every diverse groups. Like, you got your Street Fighter community, you got your Tekken community, and your DOA community, yada yada. But yeah, I try to play mostly all fighting games, whether I play it for, like, competitively or good, or just like a complete scrub.
Okay, cool. What's the game you brought us today?
Actually, like, I'm sure some of you guys thought it was going to be a fighting game, but I actually brought something that's not a fighting game. What I brought today is one of my favorite games that I got hooked on from Anime Expo, is Deathsmiles. And this was literally only available for the Xbox 360, but it actually came out in arcades first several years ago.
Oh. And tell us the genre of the game. Like, what's the genre?
From what I remember, that the company who published this game, Axis Games, because they were promoting this game at their booth, because I actually found out about this game at Anime Expo literally like almost 9 years ago, that they had a demo of it, and they said it's like a horizontal, like, side shooting scroller, like, if you think like Galaga, but instead of shooting up, you're shooting to your face, you're going right.
Oh, but so you kind of like R-Type, right?
Yeah, R-Type, yeah, because like I said, I don't know too many of these games, but when I played this game, because I was just there, as a regular consumer, like, just going around the exhibition hall, and they had a few. I was trying a bunch of games that were in development and that they were showing off at each booth, and I only went to Axis when it had Guilty Gear, but then when they had this, I'm like, all right, I'll try this, and they told me, like, they actually wanted feedback, because they were basically testing it to see if it was worth publishing here in the U.S. because, as you guys may or may not know, Axis Games publishes, like, literally Japanese games, where it's unlikely it'll be coming to the U.S., like, from major companies like Capcom or Namco Bandai. So they just publish, like, the smaller games, like Guilty Gear or BlazBlue. Like, they're so big, but it's just they would go publish it if it's not Atlus or Sega.
Okay, cool. Oh, he's gonna play a few levels of the game himself, and then I might jump in and join him, and we'll take it from there. We're about to play the game right now. Go ahead and start, man.
Yep. I love it when that church bell just, like, dings. I gotta admit, one of the things I love about this game is that I like the touch of, like, the soft of the music. Like, it's not hardcore rock. It's just Halloweenish. That's actually another thing why I like this game, because it's themed Halloweenish. Like,
yeah.
It's not something like, oh, the Nightmare Before Christmas type of stuff. So.
I just noticed that the menu, there was a lot of cards. What's the deal with the menu going on?
Okay, yeah, what that was, I can actually show you real quick.
Okay.
Basically, like, because this, like I said, this game came out in 2007, so this is the original, and then the 1.1, I don't know what the arranged version means, but this one was like a single player, and I think this was like an updated version, because I know they came out with, it was like a patch that they came out with, but I think before everything went online, they had to literally re-release it as a separate arcade cabinet or and whatnot. Kind of like how Street Fighter 2, where they literally had to keep
doing the rehashes and everything. That's their way of patching back in the day. Like, let some of the younger generation know that back then there was no such thing as patches and all that back then. When you wanted a game to get balanced or fixed, they have to make another game to fix all the problems. And you'll have, like, five copies of the same game, even though they play differently and they're added on. So each one of these is just a version of the game. You have the arcade version, then you got the upgraded version of the arcade, and then you got the console version of the game, right?
Yeah. From what I heard from Access Games, who was actually that had the build of it at Anime Expo back then, they just said one of the differences is the screen adjustment, like, because the arcade version screen is like really small. I don't know what the arcade cabinet looked like, because it was only in Japan, but I think it's also the different difficulties set up. Like, I know the 1.1 is, because it's a single player only, I think it was kind of like a survival or challenge mode. And then this one is called Mega Label Black, which was another update that came out in 2008, because it was basically the same game, but it added this character that's on the icon named Sakura, who she's a boss that you get to fight against in the original version, but with the console version of Mega Label Black, you get to play as her. So that's one of the cool things about this update. It's like, okay, because like the little small communities that like this game, when they saw her, they're like, I want to play this character. And sure enough, they came out with a new update labeled MBL Mega Black Label, and you get to play as Sakura. So, but basically, we're going to start with the arcade version, and I'm only going to play one stage for each one, so we can just get through all the versions, because I actually noticed one time that the difficulty was different, where I did kept dying a couple times in each version.
Okay. So, we're in the character selection. Can you tell me any of the characters' background story? Tell me hers, for example.
Windia came from a rich family, like, from England, but was kidnapped, but then teleported into the world where it's all Halloweenish, because the weird thing about the game is that all of the characters that you play as, they all have different origins, and given some unknown circumstances, they teleport to a world where it's Halloweenish, and the girls are not related, the playable characters, they're not related whatsoever, and the Don Bier is like the spin that each girl meets and adopts them as his daughters. So. And over time, like, for the past few years that they've lived in this world, they get familiars and they gain these powers, and they just try to get used to their new life in this new world, which I guess each girl doesn't have a problem with, because each girl seems to be comfortable and, like, they love the new place. And how they're not blood related either is because each girl's hairstyle, like, her color's different, and that they're all different ages. Like, the one that had like the vampire outfit, she's barely like 11, and then Windia, who you just saw on the screen earlier, she's 13. The one with the glasses that looks like a maid, she's actually 15, and then the character I'm actually playing as, Rosa, she's actually 17, so she would have to be the eldest daughter of the Dovier daughters.
And for this, like, the story, like, what's going on in basically the start, because we're playing the first chapter, it's Halloween, and off the bat you're just shooting, but what's the story like? Tell me the story of this game.
So someone in this world is causing a disturbance in the towns and this areas of this world, like, they're summoning all these monsters that you see on the screen, and it's disturbing the peace from the townspeople. And so the daughters feel the responsibility as Dolbear's daughters. And I'm sorry if I get the character's name wrong, because I didn't really pay attention to the character much. They feel it's their responsibility to bring the peace back into the town. So they're trying to, so the daughters are trying to investigate what, who is causing, who or what is causing these monsters to appear and cause chaos and havoc in this world.
So, can you give me more detail, like you fell in love with this game, like more detail with the depth of it?
Or, oh, yeah, yeah.
This is so, like, this is so opposite what you used to, when you see me play all the time. Like, I, like you said, you mostly play fighters, and you also play other genres, but I never, for me as a friend of him, like, I never really see him play this at all, like, at all. I've never seen him play a game like this.
Oh, yeah, like, other my other friends were so surprised because this is the kind of game that they don't expect me to play. But like I said, it's just the presentation of the game itself. It's like, the game has to appeal to me for me to buy it and then to play it. So, but yeah, one of the things why I love this game is because, again, it's like themed Halloween and it's very, to me, it's original. Like, I don't know if there's other games that were based on this or that were better. But I like this. I like the little mini story or the short story of this game and whatnot. But I just like the presentation of it. How it's just like a regular arcade game, and it just like reminds me of Galaga. But instead of shooting up, you're shooting left and right all over the screen.
Yeah.
So I already played. Like I said, I'm only gonna play one round. So I'm gonna go to the next version of. Which is, I believe, is the 1.1 single player.
And what's the one? And you just described a little bit of 1.1, so we're gonna get into it more. And can you tell us more about the difference of 1.1 out of the one we just played from the previous one?
I think from this one, because it says in the description that says it's player one only, because like in the arcade version, the original arcade, you could have just jumped in and joined in to play like it's co-op. But this one, is, I think it's kind of like a survival challenge.
And pick a different character. We want to see someone else with different abilities. I am interested in the lore. You just picked her already.
Yeah, I have to pick a random character because there's only like 15 seconds. So you got Rosa, you got Follett, and then you got Windia, and then the youngest of the group, Casper.
And there's more, is there any more, like you say, there's more characters?
Yeah,
but it's in the other patches, right?
Yeah, it's in the Mega Black label, but it's only Sakura, so you only get to play as five characters.
And I do like the way the artwork and the presentation about this, especially the sprites, like.
Yeah.
Like
that's what drew me from this thing. Huh, it's not letting me shoot. I think it is kind of a challenge mode because.
Oh, wow, I see.
Oh, okay, no, now I know what it is because the control settings are different because on the 360, you just press A and B, and then on the left and right trigger, it's like the rapid fire. But for the 1.1, you have to press RT and then LT to shoot.
Huh.
Yeah, I guess there was just the difference in control schemes. But like I said, this game was not that well known. Like, company like Axis barely published it, and of course, like the majority of people in America are not gonna know this type of game. Like, it's not gonna be up there like with Mario, Zelda, or
any of the popular mainstream stuff.
Like Halo or Final Fantasy. Yeah, it's one of those. This, I don't want to call this an indie game because this game is so much more than an indie.
Yeah.
Because the company that actually made this game and published it in Japan called Cave. They're known for making these types of vertical shooter games. And I've seen a couple, like, on the 360, because back then, like, when the 360 was still young, like, Japan was really trying to make the Xbox 360, like, the hypest console next to the PlayStation, but obviously that didn't work out. And there's like, a lot of games besides this one that only came out on Xbox, which I wish it would have came out, like, on PlayStation or... and whatnot. So I'm kind of hoping, like, if there's an anniversary for this version, like, that'll get re-released on Xbox One or PS4, because I would totally buy it. Or even a sequel and it comes to the PS4.
That'd be cool.
Yeah, and probably adding more characters wouldn't actually hurt, to be honest. So I can't pause out in between selecting a stage, so I'm gonna have to exit through each start of the mission.
And do you know if the company has done other projects? Like the people who worked on this one, do they have other projects too? Have they done or?
Sadly, I don't have that information because this is the only game I followed, and like I haven't kept track with Cave's record like in years since this game came out. But I know they've done other games. I can't remember which one was the last one. Okay, so we're playing the 360 version. One of the differences because like the resolution of the sprites is more visually upgraded. And it has a tutorial mode, so the 361 has a tutorial mode. So we're gonna pick Fallout, and we're gonna pick a different stage this time. We'll go with Forest of the Lost.
And
uh-huh.
And for the game and the story mode, for the story, have they succeeded their goal or anything? Like, have they really kept the peace basically in their own town?
Yeah, what they found out basically, who it was. It's actually Sakura's father, because he's trying to open a gate to the real world, and because he wants to go back to the human world because he's sick and tired of living in this dimension full of monsters and all this Halloween stuff and whatnot. So basically he's just trying to find a way to go back home because he doesn't want to live in this world anymore and that it's intoxicating. So but in doing so, by opening a gate that takes them back to the real world, that all these monsters are released. But for him, he doesn't care because all he cares about is that he gets to go home with his daughter and his wife. But yeah, sorry if I'm not looking at the camera, guys, because there's just so many enemies on the screen, and I already lost a health bar, so.
No, it's okay, and sorry for me stepping out of camera for a bit, because he was really focused into the game, and I did not really want to ask him questions, because looking at the game and seeing all the bullets coming out, it's very hard to, like, play this. Like, you gotta really dodge it and bob and weave and everything.
And I'll let you guys know when you get to the final boss stage, or the semi-boss stage.
Yeah.
Have fun with that because they're gonna literally cover the whole screen and you're just gonna be like, why? But one thing I love about this game, even if I die so many times, I can just continue. Like, in other games I would get frustrated, but this game I'll be like, nope, I gotta see this through to the end. Like, I don't care, like, I don't care what. Because one of the things about what I don't like about this game, like, that kind of like in some Street Fighter games, it's kind of like you get a high score for how well you perform because it's based on an arcade version. What I don't like about it is that you when you die, that your score goes back to zero. And you have to regain that score again for as much as you can before the stage is clear.
And the one we're playing now is the one with the additional character and additional features, right?
Yeah, this is the 1.1, just like the other one, where I guess the control schemes are different, but...
And keep going, I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, it's fine. I was going to say, yeah, this one has Sakura, who is the additional character for this version, but like John says, we're going to go through all the characters. So we did Windia, Fallen, Rosa, and we're just going to go to Casper.
And I would like to know more about the characters you pick, because I would like to know more background stories behind them. You told us one character so far.
Yeah, each girl is different. let's see. From what I can gather, because I only knew like Windia's story so far, but like I never really paid attention to the other characters. I just knew I just went by their character endings and where. Each girl has to face a challenge at a young age where they need to decide, like, should they stay home with their new family or should they try to go back to the real world? Because, like I said earlier, like, the reason why the Sakura's dad, I can't remember his name, he's just trying to open a gate that leads them back to the human world because he wants to go home. But depending on which girl you use and you beat them with, after you beat the final boss, he gives the girl an opportunity, Sakura's dad just basically abandons her, and then Sakura just tells the four daughters, that this is their one chance to go back home to where they truly belong. And what I like about this game is that that you get to choose, you make the choice of either staying in this world, or you go back to where you truly belong. And the results is different, you get a different ending. And I hate this boss character because of how ridiculous it is. Yeah, guys, this is the giant cow Mary. A green grass-looking cow named Mary.
At least this game doesn't take itself that serious. It knows what to come back with it, but that's cool. And so each character is basically, you get to choose the ending for them if you want in the end, right?
Yeah.
And they get to decide if they want to go home or stay in this realm.
Yeah, because they have a new life in this new world, and the man that took them in is basically like a father to them, and he did so much for them that they wouldn't feel right if they just leave him.
Yeah.
Because they've made that much of a relationship with their new family in a short few years.
Cool.
I'm sorry if I can't be more descriptive because
it's okay.
Been so long. Cause
no, I tell everybody who's on the show is whatever they want to share about their favorite games and tell us more about the stories. And you did a great job on it because it's like you brought in the stuff that people are curious about and they know more. And I did want to play with you now in this game. So this is the one that's eligible to play two players. Or no,
it should be, because this is the arcade version. Given how the sprites are looking, I think if you press start, you can join in.
Okay, cool.
So I'm gonna play Rosa because that's who I've been using for years, and she's literally my favorite character out of the four daughters.
All right. I'm going to use Sakura because you haven't used her at all throughout the video, so...
Because I was going to use her for the console version.
Okay, cool.
But, you know what, I'll stick with Follett because she's an alternate character, and then we'll go to... We can just go to the one that I did earlier, the Forest of the Lost, and we'll set the level, the difficulty to 2. Because I don't know if you guys noticed, but you guys surely noticed, I beat all these guys so easily.
And before we start, tell me the buttons real quick.
A is shooting left and B is shooting right.
Oh,
and
wow.
Yeah. And then, like I said, RT and LT are the quick triggers, but on the 1.1 single player, that's the triggers. But just remember, some of these enemies that you shoot on the screen, like the centipede-looking thing, there are some enemies that it takes a while for you to kill. So just be careful when you shoot, because...
Yeah, I can see there's a lot of stuff on screen. It's very cool.
I know, when you get to the boss stage, before you even get to the semi-boss or the final boss, when you have to beat the pre-stage before you get to the boss, there's a lot of enemies that cover the whole screen. If you press Y, you can throw your bomb attack. So if you get cornered by enemies, you press Y and I'm about to do, it literally destroys all the enemies right there.
And I want to ask you, how can you not get super frustrated? I'm trying to dodge everything and I'm trying to keep cool, but it's kind of hard.
I want to give you a legitimate answer, but to me, I just don't get frustrated. Call it therapeutic or whatever, but it's just one of those games that I don't get frustrated. I don't get I don't get that rage quit, where I just throw the controller to say F it.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I just enjoy the game so much where it's even if I die 100 times, it doesn't bother me.
Yeah, because I barely made it out of there. I'm down on my last bar, and I'm getting a little frustrated, to be honest.
Sometimes if you touch the enemies before they shoot you, you lose half a health. But if they hit you with a projectile, then you lose full health. If depending how much time we have left, we're just gonna go to the 360 one.
Because let's do it.
Well, yeah, because if there's enough time, I would want our viewers to try to see us progress a bit more. So if we get a chance, like you get to see Sakura's father. I think I remember his name. It's Jitterbug.
If you want, we could keep playing until we could make it like. Because usually my episodes end around 30-ish.
Yeah, so. With co-op, it should go fast, especially if we just set the difficulty to 1. So, and we're doing it for our viewers so they can get a chance, because maybe they want to pick up a copy of this game. Because as old as this game is, you can get this game pretty cheap. Like, if you go to GameStop, you can probably get it like under $7. And that's, to me, that's a steal.
And before we talk about, you know, buying it, is it only for consoles, right? For 360?
Yeah, this game is, unfortunately, it's only for the Xbox 360 and no other consoles. I believe I heard a rumor that it might be backwards, it will be added to the backwards compatibility for Xbox One. I know the sequel that was only in Japan, Deathsmiles 2, X2. It's still the Halloween kind of theme, but it's set in the winter, so it's like a Christmas slash Halloween, like, it's, like, from what I've seen from screenshots or videos, it has that Nightmare Before Christmas kind of vibe, where it's like, oh, it's Halloween, but it's Christmassy-ish, and I think they introduced 2 new characters. I don't know their names specifically, because, I didn't even know about the sequel until like 2 years ago, or actually 5. But I didn't think it would be available here. But to my disbelief, before Xbox One came out, you can actually buy the sequel for $30, I think, digitally on Xbox Live for the 360. And I think that might be on the backwards compatible list. I'm not too sure, because I don't have an Xbox One. I just go by what I see on my 360. So hopefully after this holiday, like for Black Friday, is done and gone, hopefully this game will finally be on sale. I'll just get this on Cyber Monday, because not playing this game again, I feel like I have to play the sequel. And then also, John, do you see how my score says 1,000 on the bottom and it's glowing?
Yeah.
If it's glowing, if you hold X, you get a power-up boost where I think it does more damage.
Oh, okay.
So that's why it's important that, like, that you don't die and before you respawn. But one thing also, too, is that once you use it, your meter goes down. So you gotta, like, refill it up again. Which is not a problem, but it's good to have as a reliable source, because when you use your bombs, you only use up to 3 bombs, and if you waste it, just save up your meter. Like right now, how yours is going at 500.
Yeah.
You can use it, but
you want it to 1,000.
Yeah, because you want to make it last. But I think I'm gonna die too, but I'm gonna use it now so we can just kill like the marching band of enemies shooting us in the swamp.
Okay.
But I know this is your first time playing it, but what's your take on this, John? Like, what do you think of this game?
I've been a fan of games like these, like R-Type, but more like traditional. The closest thing I can say is Defender. You know, when you fly that ship in Atari, you defend the lower bombs of the sea from the land. So I'm used to this, but at the same time, I'm not, because there's so much stuff on screen. It's cluttering. It's,
yeah, that's what.
But I do like the appeal of it. I do like the story you just told me, that they're in a different world. They're being raised by this you know, this father figure, right?
Yeah.
And it's pretty cool. And then the fact you told me that you can make a decision and you have to go back to the real world or stay here. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah, I think if you read the if you guys buy a copy of this game, or I think you can go to the website too, because I believe Axis Games has it on. Has the website still up? Because I think that's another way you can buy a brand new copy through the link. One of the cool things about when the Xbox 360 was still young is that the original Xbox, the really fat one. That's another thing I forgot to mention about the Xbox version. There's dialogue between the characters. I think it's in the arcade also, but since we haven't made it that far. This is the stage where you fight Sakura as a boss before she became playable. Because all you can, because she was only a boss character, and she would only go with you, like, for the story purpose, but she was never fully playable until the Mega Black Label version.
No, I like that. Like I said, I'm very old school retro games, I guess, so the closest thing I could say is Galaga. That's, like, I don't really play a lot of these type of style genre games.
Yeah.
But I do like the story so far. I think I might end up picking up a copy.
Yeah, one of the things I like, too, that makes it so obscure, or not obscure, but just interesting, is that each of the daughters, including Sakura, come from different origins. Like, Casper, she's from Germany. Rosa, she's from the U.S. That's why she calls Sakura sweetheart, if you saw the little dialogue. Windia is from London, I believe.
And the thing is, I'm a little more intrigued about the environment. What time period does it take place? Like, it feels like it's in the early 1800s or...
Well, like in the modern world, it's not specified because you don't play the stages of their real world, but because this new world is like Halloween, that's what I feel like. I think in this world it's still modern, but their version of, or their perspective or the modern in this world is like, as you said, like the 1800s, maybe even the 14th century, like, because to them, like, modern, like, it's like you said, it's like the old days where, because they don't have, like, phones or computers and stuff, like, everything's traditional. Because, as you see, like, this game is Halloween-ish, like, they still use candles and lanterns and whatnot.
And I do like that, because, to be honest, one of my favorite time periods, besides the 30s and the 1930s and all that, I did like the 1800s because of the whole traditional, everything was starting to be modernized and I do like the art style of this game's running. And it does have that Halloween feel like you're saying.
Yeah. I just like the it's not even just about the theme anymore at this point, like, because going back to playing this game again, it's mostly just, like, the presentation, and it's just something different that completely intrigued me, and even though I don't play this game that often anymore, like, you would think, like, for most guys or girls who have this game, like, this would be one of those games where they would trade it into GameStop or sell it to, or give it to a friend. But I'm going to just hold on to it for, like, I guess, like, this is just kind of exaggerating. Like, I'm going to just keep this game until the end, like, until the sands of time or until my time comes where I'm no longer in this world. But that's kind of, like I said, it's kind of exaggerating it. But, like, let me put it in a better way. Like, even if I'm, like, 80 years old, I'll keep this game and I'll play it, like, because when you become old, like, what are you going to do in your spare time? Like, I'll do what I did when I was younger. Play video games.
And that's a great hobby to have, to be honest.
Yeah, because it was different back then when we were growing up, but, like, in today's society, it's like, people don't, like, there are still people that judge, like, that it's a waste of time. I'm like, you know what? It's, like, especially for kids with autism or any disability, it's a stress reliever.
It is.
Yeah. Because that's why that's a funny story where that's why I like fighting games, is because it was like my therapy, where if I was so frustrated, I just pretend like people that annoyed me was my opponent, and I just like beat the tart out of them. Like, especially like in games like Mortal Kombat. But it's all for laughs and giggles.
It is. And it's like, gaming for me, it was an outlet and all that, besides music.
Yeah.
But I was just a gamer at heart. Like, I just love gaming because of the stories and the characters, and that's all anybody can say about gaming when they got into it, because of stories and characters.
To be honest, like, because you brought up a good point about music. To be honest, like, today's music, I think the video game music, like, especially the tracks in this game, they're actually a lot more better than today's modern music, like, you hear on the radio or, like...
And it's true, because the thing is, a lot of people don't give second thoughts about gaming music. If you listen to it, there's a lot of composing, a lot of things, because they have to build the music around a theme of the level, or the theme of the game, too. Like,
yeah.
They have to multitask the themes, like, okay, the theme of the game is Halloween-ish, okay. So you use these type of instruments to have that Halloween feel. But we also have to music... for the level. So we have to use these type of instruments in a certain way to fit in the level.
Yeah, like the theme music that played against the boss, which I didn't see his name because the thing we were...
We just cluttered it up.
Well, it showed the name, but we didn't see it and weren't paying attention to it, but...
It gets addicted, I agree. This game is addicting, I'm getting...
No, but... That's what's weird too. You get to choose like different parts of levels, but I think you gotta complete, like go back to certain ones before you can advance.
Yeah.
Kind of like conquering the stages and whatnot. So this one should be very easy though, especially with two players.
And I would like to say, sorry we're almost out of time, but we're gonna play this last level and basically give out our final thoughts.
Yeah. Yeah, like I said, guys, like we were gonna try to play, get to the boss level, but since we only have a certain amount of time doing this, at least you got to see more of the stages. But yeah, it's better this way too, because then there's no spoiler alerts of which ending is which. So, because that would be something for you guys to figure out and for you to play the game yourself and find out.
Yeah.
Or just go on YouTube and look up the endings.
Yeah, this is a great way to get into it and evolve. Like, you know, your curiosity. This builds your curiosity. Like, you saw how the themes are, you saw how the gameplay is, you saw how multiplayer works together, and you got a little bit of story in the part of the previous part. And, you know, for sure, I am going to buy a copy, because I am actually hooked right now, and it's really hard to look at the camera while you're playing.
Yeah, that's why, again, I apologize, guys, if we're not really looking at the camera, because just like in probably John's other episodes, like, you're talking, but you're still playing at the same time, so we're not ignoring you guys, so, like, the fact that you guys are watching and you're paying attention, it's appreciated, and I made the mistake of being next to the boss.
Wow, that's quick. Well, that's just the first half.
Yeah, unfortunately, some of the bosses in this game, like this one and the giant cow Mary that you guys saw earlier, like they come back in the boss stages later, but they die quickly. But they're still annoying to deal with because you got like hordes and hordes of enemies coming at you across the screen. So it's like especially when you get to the last level, it does get a bit frustrating. So, but like with me, I'm hoping this game doesn't frustrate you guys too bad. So, because this is just a good classic game. Because that's the thing I love about this game the most, is because we know we're never going to see nothing like this outside of the U.S. again, so...
Yeah, it's a really good gem, and I like how it's unique, it's almost art style, it has a lot of things going for it, and to be honest, we don't see a lot of Eastern games coming to America like this. We see, like, mostly fighters or action-adventure, but a game like this, it's like, it goes under the radar and doesn't get noticed by the mainstream crowd, but it's a real cool gem. And this is what the channel's all about: picking up gems that you'll never thought there was a game of this and a game with feel of that or a theme based like this for a game. It's like, so thanks again, Jose, for being on my show, man. And he is going to be coming back for another episode, for a special version of an episode we're going to do later next month with the previous guest we have. And if you're wondering, yes, we are in my previous guest's home, Zach, and he let us use his place because mine is being fixed up, and his was kind of getting fixed up too for a different reason. So, you want to wait till the camera's back? Let him know that you're part of the contributing person. Just wave hello for letting us use your room as a studio. See, this is what happens when you have friends who are into wrestling. Thank you again, guys.
Yeah, bye, guys. Hopefully we'll see you next time. And Zach sends his love to you guys, too. So thank you and goodbye.
It's my house.
All right, bye.
Bye, guys.